to Confessions of a Stenographer, where we are focusing on all things steno and the state of our profession. My name is Tamara Chapman, I'm your co-host, and this is episode 14. I am a freelance stenographer and I live in Austin, Texas. I am married to a New Yorker and we are proud parents of two beautiful whippets. Music has always been a passion of mine, so it's no coincidence that I live in the live music capital of the world.
I have been reporting for over 20 years. The first half of that time was spent in Houston, Texas. I was born and raised in Pasadena, Texas. And if you've ever seen the movie Urban Cowboy, that's where I was raised. Yes, Bud, Sissy, Pam, the Mechanical Bull, dancing on the dance floor at Gilly's. I will admit that I have ridden the Mechanical Bull. And I've also danced on the dance floor a few times. If you met me in person, this might be a little hard to imagine, but those are my roots. I've discovered court reporting in my third year of college. I was waiting tables at my part-time job, and a customer told me about a woman he knew that was a court reporter and was making tons of money. I was about 21 years old. I loved to shop, and my dream was to travel the world. So I was very intrigued. Let's just say I went to court reporting school for perfectly shallow reasons. But it definitely was one of the better decisions I've made in my life. I have had a very rewarding career with lots of travel and interesting and high-profile cases. It has been exciting to watch the advancements in technology and in our CAT software that have made providing real-time and producing a transcript as quick and as seamless as it is today. The certifications I hold are the Texas CSR, the Registered Professional Reporter, and the Certified Real-Time Reporter. And I also have the RMR on my to-do list. Tamara's Steno Hacks. This is a Facebook group I created. After years of collecting briefs and phrase parts and out-of-the-box steno concepts and ideas, a few friends encouraged me to start a Facebook group. My goal was to create a space to share content that I had collected over the years with fellow reporters, as well as being a space for reporters to ask questions and to share tips and tricks that they have come across. And given that I jokingly refer to myself as a technology evangelist, and I like to encourage reporters to write real time, this group would also be an avenue to share some of the helpful ideas that just might give someone the confidence to do real time and to work on their translation, so that a last-minute rough draft would be a bonus rather than a pain. With the advancements in voice recognition and digital reporting sneaking its way into our profession, it is important now, more than it ever has been, to be the best writers we can be, utilize our CAT software and all of the features, and up our game with technology. I do not believe that technology will ever replace a court reporter, but we must do our part. Embrace technology. Spend time learning new ways to shorten our writing and incorporate tips and tricks. Have a great dictionary. All of these things not only keep us way ahead of VR, but also make our workdays less stressful, give us more time to spend with our family, and more time to do the things that you love. Here are a few things that you will see in Tamara's Steno Hacks. Learn Windows, or Mac if that's what you're using. Write short, learn briefs and phrase parts. Keep your software up to date and know your software and the more advanced features, or just know your software, period. As you listen to me today, it will be obvious that I have strong feelings about these things, so I will say this. My opinions are meant to be motivational and not judgy, and so I hope that you will hear them that way. Windows. In talking to reporters this past year, I have found that many have been getting by with minimal knowledge of Windows. And that served them fine until the pandemic happened. And then it was a crash course in all things technology. An excellent place to get up to speed on technology is YouTube. There are tons of videos, and all you need to know are some topics to search for. And sometimes that can be the hardest part. Here are a few things you can search for. Virtual desktops. Adjusting your sound settings and making a desktop shortcut to your sound settings so that you can troubleshoot your audio problems quicker because you only need to click an icon on your desktop to get to them. How to manage and organize the files on your computer. I did notice when logging into reporters' computers, quite a few people that had tons of files on their desktop without any organization. I won't pretend that my computer is a shining example of what a clean and organized computer looks like, but I do use a folder system. And an insider tip for keeping your desktop clean is a Windows app called Fences. Google that. Let's talk a second about function keys. I have seen this question 100 times in the last few years. I got a new computer and my function keys aren't working, or something to that effect. Type this into a Google search. Enable, disable function keys. Include your PC manufacturer because the instructions vary by manufacturer. And if you're lucky, on the top left of your keyboard, you'll see a function lock key. Chances are you'll be getting another computer someday, multiple times probably, and so now you know. Writing short. If you look at my briefs database, you will see tons of what are called LHPSs and RHPEs. If you know, you know. If not, LHPS stands for left hand phrase starter, and RHPE stands for right hand phrase ender. Are you using these? If so, great. If not, bump that up to the top of your to-do list and you can thank me later. Phrases that come up repeatedly, why write them out? One of my sources for phrase parts in briefs and pretty much all things Steno is Mark Kislingberry's Magnum Steno. I have Mark's personal dictionary and have spent many hours searching through it like I'm looking for gold, and I usually do find some. If you are a student or just out of school, or maybe you've been reporting for quite a while and you're looking to do real time or clean up your translation so you will have less editing time, do yourself a favor. Incorporate Mark's phrase parts. His Steno outlines are more shaped based as opposed to outlines that might be more obvious. Some people just don't get the way he does things, that it's kind of weird. But I happen to like weird. I live in Austin and we keep it weird here. If you can train your brain to use a shape concept, the possibilities are endless. And if you think about it, you're already using shapes. The final PBLG looks nothing like the J sound. I'll share a few all-stars from my personal dictionary that I've gotten from him. TW for the only. Some examples of phrases with this phrase starter are the only reason, the only one, the only way, and the only thing. The only one, TW, then final N. The only reason, TW, final RN. The only way, TW, final FRTS, and the only thing, TW, FRLG. The right-hand phrase ender for thing and way are great examples of shapes. And these two are easy to confuse. The way I keep them straight is, and I heard this from one of Mark's students, final FRTS for way, your fingers are way apart. Let's talk about the asterisk for a moment. I really like the asterisk. I've heard people say that they didn't learn it in school and they don't use it. Since we have a small keyboard which requires some creativity, don't let it go to waste. I use the asterisk to differentiate a few phrase enders. I use the asterisk and the final F to make the V sound, saving the F for the F or the S or C sound. You can use the asterisk to resolve conflicts. A tip for using the asterisk, though, be very precise when you use it and when you don't. If you think of asterisk kind of like a shift key, what about the number bar? That's like having another shift key, or a double asterisk, if you will. Say you have 3 dictionary entries that you want to use the same Steno outline for because you haven't been able to work them out. Using the number bar and the asterisk in combination with those outlines, you can still use the same Steno outline. You'll have the outline without the asterisk, with the asterisk. You'll have it with a number bar. You'll have it with a number bar and the asterisk. So that's 4 different options for the same Steno outline. If you never learned the number bar or you just don't like using it, don't ignore all the options that the number bar gives you besides just writing numbers. There are other ways to use the number bar. Mark Kislingberry uses the number bar to resolve some conflicts, but he seems to mostly use it to add the word the in front of a word or phrase. So you write apple, A-E-P-L, reach up and grab the number bar in the outline and you have the apple. I use the number bar quite often to add the word to the end of a word or phrase. I write, do you want, D-A-O-U-P-T, and if they say to, then I reach up and add the number bar to the outline. Something clever you can do with a number bar is to combine it with steno. Claim one, hold down the number one on the number bar and then add A-I-M. Phase one, hold down the one and then A-I-Z. And so on with numbers 2 to 4. I say it again, tiny keyboard, get creative. Another excellent source for briefs for phrases is Linda Lee's Brief Relief. She also has a Brief Relief 2, which is full of word briefs. Her briefs are more phonetic, but she keeps them skeletal, which helps avoid potential conflicts. One of my favorite phrase starters that I learned from Linda is DW for do you know. I'm sure sitting here, you can think of quite a few do you know phrases. Here are just a few examples. Do you know when? D-W-E-N. Do you know where? D-W-E-R. Do you know which? D-W-I-F-P. Do you know if? D-W-I-F. Do you know how? D-W-O-U. Here is her look phrase starter family. Look, L-A-O. Take a look, T-L-A-O. There, all I did was add on the T to make it take a look. Let's look. S-L-A-O. Let's take a look. S-T-L-A-O. You all have phrase enders on the right side, but that's the look family. Does that phrases? S-D for does. Does that sound? S-D-A-S. Does that sound right? S-D-A-R-S. Does that sound about right? S-D-A-R-B-S. And if you tack on the U to those outlines, then you add to you to the end of them. Does that sound right to you? Does that sound about right to you? Does that ring a bell? S-D-A-R-B-L. Does that make sense? S-D-A-M-S. Tack on the U and you get, does that make sense to you? I have a limited amount of time today. I'm sure Linda doesn't mind me giving out a few examples. I would need hours to spotlight the great briefs from her books. Highly recommend. In working out some of my conflicts, I discovered Bouquet's briefs. You can order her book or access her database online. What's interesting is you can put your dictionary in a spreadsheet, upload it to her website. Then you can search for a brief and then see what your steno stroke is right next to it. Her briefs are unique and concepts I had never heard of. For example, allocate, Y-L-O-E-K-T. You take the sounds from the first two syllables and tack on O-E-K-T. Chances are you're already writing locate, L-O-E-K-T. Alone, Y-L-O-E-N. Something else that I have incorporated in the last few years is using word pairs. In this instance, I'm using A-U-B for the word number, then adding on the sound from the word preceding number to make the brief. Page number, P-A-U-B. Bates number, B-A-U-B. Exhibit number, X-A-U-B. I know that was a lot of information, and before I transition into something besides steno, I wanted to say a few things to the younger reporters out there. And now this is going to be Mama Bear steno advice. This is from years of undoing a hodgepodge dictionary of collecting this brief and that brief and not really thinking it through and creating families and having a system to how I was doing things. If you come across a brief that you might want to incorporate, it's fine to just use it for that day. Sit down and evaluate how you're going to add this to your dictionary and what other things can you use that are similar. So you have similar patterns. What you don't want to have is sometimes I use an asterisk, sometimes I don't, sometimes I do it this way. Be very, very strict with how you do things because later on you will find yourself hesitating or writing the wrong word or having to incorporate more conflicts because you haven't worked these things out. So bottom line, strategically add things to your dictionary. Hodgepodges are cute, but they're not cute in your dictionary. Here's one more piece of advice. Don't neglect your prefixes and suffixes. Get them straight in your dictionary. I always had prefixes and suffixes, but I kind of stopped paying attention. Now I'm working with Anissa from Learn to Caption. She's been helping me quite a bit with that. And it's amazing to watch your software translate words that aren't in your dictionary because you have proper prefixes and suffixes and word parts in your dictionary. Know your software and keep up with support so that you have the latest version of your software. If you had available to you something that would make your writing cleaner, would lessen the amount of time that you're editing, or what about a feature that you can implement that gives you the confidence to do real time? Wouldn't you want to know what that is? As voice recognition technology is getting better and better, so is our CAT software. Let me ask you a few questions. Do you know what features have been added in your software in the last few years? Are you using them? Do you know they're there, but you're not sure how to use them, and you just haven't taken the time to learn them? Did you know that you can get software training remotely? Did you know that software training is tax deductible and you can earn continuing education credits? I see people on Facebook saying this a lot. I don't need support. It's expensive and I never call in for support. Please listen to what I'm about to say. This is very important. It's not about calling support when you need help. It's supporting the development of the software that continues to add features to help us stay miles ahead of voice recognition. I remember when I first started reporting, before computers were anything like they are today, I would hear that annoying comment, "Isn't voice recognition going to take over anyway?" For years, I have laughed this off and said, "People have been saying that for years." I don't know if you have seen voice recognition lately. While the translation can look a bit like an unedited transcript on one of your worst days, and it's got a huge homonym problem, it doesn't suck as bad as it used to. But seriously, this is no laughing matter. The best way to get to know your software is to work with a trainer one-on-one. I've done this for years. Not only will you learn new things, you can also work out those translation glitches that have driven you crazy for years. And what if you took the time and learned something that was a game changer? Like a tiny adjustment to your settings that helped your translation so much that you're ready to offer real time, and you thought you never would be. One of the best features in our software is number conversion. When incorporating this, I recommend working with a trainer because it's not just about learning number conversion, it's about sweeping your dictionary for entries that prevent it from working correctly. And if you're doing exhibit indexes manually, stop. As soon as you can, work with a trainer and set this up. Not only is doing your index manually a big waste of time, it also increases the chance of making mistakes. Back to number conversion. I resisted incorporating number conversion for years. I used the number bar. I felt like I wrote what I wanted to translate, and what I'm doing works for me. These are all things that I've heard other people say as well. But really, people, let the software do the work. It's not cheap, so you might as well let it do some heavy lifting, right? There are things in your software that you can do to help push out an unexpected rough at the end of the day. We must be ready for a rough draft when asked, and not have it take days to prepare. Remember, voice recognition can prepare a rough draft. It may not look pretty, but still. You may have conflicts that are keeping you from doing real time. Conflicts are okay. I learned the StenEd theory, no conflicts. But I'm pretty sure StenEd wasn't written with software artificial intelligence in mind. If you are captioning, of course, you don't want any conflicts. But you can be a real-time writer with conflicts if you have them set up correctly in your software. I don't let the AI choose my conflicts because I haven't taken the time to train the software. But a lot of people use AI and they love it. After the shelter-in-place orders were issued, after wiping away the tears on my face, after watching 20 depots cancel and a huge case I was about to start, I was ready to work. I have an amazing team that I could not do what I do without, that I wanted to support, so I took almost anything I could. I was pretty busy, and then the Zoom hiccup happened. Weeks of nothing. I started following Zoom security updates, hoping they would get their act together and win people's confidence so that the depots would start scheduling. The work that I was taking during this time was really not my type of work. It seemed mostly personal injury attorneys were the only ones brave enough to take a remote deposition. Lately, though, thankfully, I've been getting back to my usual somewhat. An expert witness and intellectual property is my jam. I'm not crazy about source code depots, but I could listen to a damages expert in a patent case talk about Georgia-specific factors for days, or an expert talking about what one of ordinary skill in the art would know. I don't know if I want to go back to in-person depots, but I'm not totally in love with working remotely. Someone asked me on New Year's Eve how I liked working remotely. Well, if I were to break out the old pros and cons list for remote versus in-person, they pretty much cancel each other out. I do love the commute, and I suppose I could deal with the irritating parts of remote depots for a while longer, or maybe forever. Initially, setting things up wasn't much of a challenge. It's definitely changed a time or three or four or five. Though I had never done a Zoom depot, really. For as long as I can remember, I have split the videographer feed and recorded and monitored the audio. If there was ever not a videographer present, I would use a digital recorder and set it up the same way. The only difference at home was that I was recording audio from one computer to another, which presented a whole new set of issues, and then I was wearing headphones over both ears instead of one. At some point, my scopist let me know that my voice was not making it into my CAT software. I know almost everybody has struggled with this. I have many setups. Only a few of them get my voice into my CAT software. But since it's important now more than ever that we speak up for the record, and since I'm not one of those who can write and speak at the same time, I need my audio to be inside of my CAT software. And I've tried quite a few different things. I've used splitters and mixers, a digital recorder plugged into a special splitter that mixed the Zoom audio with my voice. When I purchased a new microphone to record this podcast, to my surprise, it had a headphone output, and now my setup is perfect. Now I will attempt to describe my workstation and go into a little more detail about my setup. I will also make sure that there are links in the show notes to the products that I am mentioning. In front of me, I have a desktop computer with an extra monitor. I am connected to Zoom on this device. I mark exhibits on this device. And this device is a source of the audio that goes into my CAT computer. For backup audio, I have an iPad with a separate Zoom connection, which is handy when something happens to your main audio source. Not only does this give you a local audio backup if you have it connected to a digital recorder, it's also a way to notify people in Zoom that you are having technical problems should you get disconnected from your main Zoom connection. Chances are nobody will know you've been disconnected and they'll just keep going. I don't know if it's happened to you, but I've had people go on the record when I've not been at my desk. With this iPad, I have created a second login. I changed the name on the profile to be Reporter Audio Device. This makes it less confusing when people are making you co-host when you have two connections as to which one to connect to. I still get contacted by reporters who are struggling with getting audio into their CAT computer, so I will attempt to describe this. Maybe what I'm doing will work for you. You'll hear me refer to an aux cable or auxiliary cable. The end of it resembles a regular headphone cable, except it has two male ends. Auxiliary cables look the same, but they're not all created equal. As a quick aside, if you have purchased auxiliary cables and your audio isn't working, chances are you have the wrong type of auxiliary cable. You need an auxiliary cable with a different connector. And I won't even try to describe that. It's got to do with tip ring, sleeve. If you want to take those words, and you'll know the direction you need to go to try to solve your problem. I will also refer to an Andrea sound card. This is something that I plug into my CAT computer, which has a headphone port and a microphone port. On my Zoom computer, I have a USB microphone plugged into it. I have one end of an auxiliary cable plugged into the headphone port on this microphone. The other end of the auxiliary cable is plugged into the mic input of the Andrea sound card. I then plug my headphones into the headphone jack on the Andrea sound card, and this is how I hear audio. My voice is also recorded in my CAT software this way. This has been the best setup so far because I'm not hearing myself speak and the mic doesn't seem to be picking up many extraneous sounds such as dogs barking. In the past, I have used a Windows app called Mic Mute, which will actually mute the microphone, so you definitely won't hear barking in your recording. Other things I use in my setup are a programmable foot pedal to temporarily unmute myself in Zoom. This pedal can be programmed as a key or key combo. I've had it for years and years and finally found a regular use for it. It works perfectly in Zoom. If you have Catalyst, you can use this pedal for audio sync as well. It comes in a 1 and 2 pedal configuration, so if you want to use it for audio sync, I would get the 2 pedal, program one to temporarily unmute yourself, the other one to stop and start audio. I use a programmable ergonomic mouse, a totally programmable mechanical keyboard that is small enough to sit on top of my Steno machine, and I can still see the screen on the Luminex. I can also use it as a Steno keyboard with the help of the Plover program, which has my personal dictionary loaded into it. This program is free. This would be too hard to explain in a podcast, but it's one of my favorite gadgets, and I wanted to mention it. If you're interested in learning more, I have a few posts in my Facebook group. Can you tell that I like programmable accessories? I have an extra monitor now for my Zoom computer, but before that, I was using my larger iPad as a second monitor with the Duet Display app. If you have an extra monitor, be it an iPad or an actual monitor, using Zoom's dual monitor feature, you can have the participants on one screen and the shared content on the other. I find it helpful to be able to see the attorney and the witness and the exhibits on the same size window instead of one being smaller than the other. It actually splits the Zoom window so you can move one of the windows anywhere. You can also use side-by-side mode in Zoom and resize the participants or the shared content if you're not using the dual monitor. The side-by-side, there's a slider bar in the middle and you position your mouse pointer and you left-click and slide. I use a Windows app called Input Director, which I have set up to control four different computers. I believe it can control even more, but that's how many devices I have connected to it. If you are experiencing hum or feedback, purchase a few ground loop noise isolators. I've never had to use them until I started plugging computers into each other. This completely got rid of the hum. For a while, I was using Google Voice to connect to meetings and getting my audio that way into my CAT software. Google Voice, you are issued a Google phone number, and then you are dialing in using Wi-Fi instead of cellular. Since you are issued a phone number, people can call you on this number. You could use it as a business number even. If anyone leaves a message or text messages you, the messages go to your email inbox, and you can have the calls forwarded to your cell phone. All you need to get a free Google phone number and Google Voice account is a Gmail account and a cell phone or landline to link it to. If you decide to try Google Voice, I would recommend Googling the setting to keep it from disconnecting you after about 4 hours. What it does is it mistakenly senses inactivity on your connection because you're on mute. You can download the Google Voice app on an iPhone, Android. You can use it on a Chromebook as well as on a Windows device. Something I get asked about a lot is how do I get my background blurry? I do this with a Windows app called XSplit VCam. I guess the best way to describe it is it works like a filter. This works much better than a virtual background. I stay in perfect focus, yet everything behind me is blurry. You can dial it up or dial it back depending on how blurry you want to make things. Also in my setup is my Nespresso machine and my water cooler, and they are both within reach. I already mentioned the dual monitor feature and the side-by-side mode feature. If you haven't checked out the shortcuts, there are some that are really helpful. You can also change the shortcut key combo to something that's easier for you to remember. Note that there are global shortcuts, which allow the shortcut command to work even if your cursor's focus is not in Zoom, so be careful with these. I mentioned the spacebar to temporarily unmute. If you are connecting to Zoom with a browser, while it may seem more convenient, it's just as convenient to connect with a Zoom desktop client. With a desktop client, you can still just click the link to connect like you always do, but you will have the option to open up a Zoom desktop client. This is nice if you have a setting that you would like to save. Using a browser to connect, you also lose quite a few Zoom features. And if you are using a Zoom desktop client, make sure you regularly check for updates. Zoom frequently releases them. Some of them are updates that will improve your audio. Creating a Zoom account is free, in case you were wondering. Have you ever heard of Zoom Studio Effects? It's my Zoom beauty secret. To get to Zoom Studio Effects, you go to your settings and go to Background and Filters, and on the bottom right, you will see Zoom Studio Effects. You can go in and choose the eyebrows you've always wanted, and then select a lip color. You can turn up or turn down the intensity. If you're experiencing connection issues, you might need to have makeup handy, and at the next break, turn it off and put some makeup on. You can also check the box to apply to all meetings. And men, they haven't forgotten about you. There's a section you can pick out whichever kind of facial hair you'd like to wear. I've been using this for months, and it works great. Next, I'll talk about Zoom audio and how to troubleshoot. One of the first things you want to do is turn off HD on your device and shut down any programs that send and receive lots of data. If you have kids at home, a spouse that are streaming content, get on a different network if that's an option. While Zoom is running on a computer, it is processing audio and video from your device, while at the same time, it is processing and receiving audio and video to your device. If a participant or yourself have an older device or an unstable or weak internet connection, The sound is not ideal and can be horrible. Here are some ways you can troubleshoot other people's audio so that you can hear them better. Ask them if they have a headset, and the answer is usually no, but you should at least ask. And since you aren't likely to know the details about the acoustics in their room, or anything about their computer, or their internet connection, you'll just have to adjust, test, and repeat until it sounds better. One of the first things I do if I'm having trouble hearing or the connection sounds broken, I have them open up audio settings and go to mic volume and uncheck automatically adjust volume, and then turn the microphone level up to about 3/4 of the way, about 1/4 from the top, basically. If you hear background noise, have them check background noise level settings. Sometimes if this is too aggressive, it will affect the way they sound. Adjust echo cancellation settings. If you hear an echo, obviously you're going to go in and have them change their echo cancellation settings. That is, if it's not the echo from having two devices connected in one room. Ask the participant to move closer to the camera and to not look away from the computer screen. Turn off virtual backgrounds. Virtual backgrounds are computer resource and bandwidth hogs and are best left for Zoom meetings with family. And just like I mentioned about your connection, ask them if they have kids at home streaming content on the internet. And if they can't do anything about it, I ask them to switch to phone audio. So in-person depositions seem to be starting and stopping depending on how the virus is going. I've not done any and I don't plan on doing any for a while. But whenever you have the witness and an attorney in the room, they try to use the microphone for the witness. And what happens is Zoom considers anyone that's not sitting right in front of the computer as background noise, so they're not going to come through very well. So if you have two people in the same room, you want to have them on a speakerphone. I've had two people in the same room connect wearing headsets, and depending on how loud one person has their headset on, the sound from it could bleed into the other person's headphone, and then you're going to get echo or feedback. If you're hearing an echo or any feedback, sometimes it can be external speakers. So you want to ask if they're using external speakers with their computer. And then there's simultaneous speaking. It seems to be when you speak up, they try to say it's because of Zoom. I politely tell them, no, it's something that we face all the time. It's just that when it's on Zoom, when there is simultaneous speaking, everybody gets muted except for one person. And I have no control over that. And they're not going to know who that happened to until they get the transcript back. And maybe a word they said is not on the record because they were muted. I know all this sounds like a lot, and it sounds technical and maybe something you don't want to deal with, but knowing this will actually help you be able to stand up for yourself, and you'll also know how to help improve the sound so that you can make a record. Lately, it seems that quite a few attorneys are becoming less concerned with how we're hearing, even to the point of getting irritated whenever I try to stop and improve the situation. I mean, how can you make a record if you're not hearing what's being said? If an attorney says, "I've been connecting every day using the same computer with no problems," I say, great, but there's something going on today, and you never know with computers. Sometimes there's updates and settings get changed, and you have no idea that they've been changed. I've even had someone argue with me, and I try to tell them that how good it sounded yesterday does not help me hear today. And if you want to keep going, I'll just write what I hear. And that usually gets their attention. So I'll just vent here for a second. One day I actually had an attorney tell me, after stopping the deposition for the second time to troubleshoot the witness's audio, that I was delaying the proceedings and we needed to get going. And this attorney wasn't conducting the deposition. He was just the firm owner of this large firm with 10 floors and he was just listening in. But he told me, none of the other reporters have had trouble hearing on the other days. And I said, I'm sure you know this, but this is a different witness with a different Zoom connection with different signal strength. And that doesn't really apply to today. Now, this witness was in an RV connecting with a phone. So as you can imagine, it was pretty bad. Never forget that you are making a record. If you're not hearing, even if there is a videographer, it's not going to make it on the record because the sound is not making it into Zoom. I think attorneys have gotten too used to relying on the video. So when they simultaneously speak in in-person depositions, they just think, oh, the video's got it. And they've started having that same attitude with Zoom. I'm sure that once they get around to reading the transcript, they might actually be a little bit more helpful. For the most part, I've had pretty good experiences with troubleshooting. I just think it's best to know as much as you can so that when you do troubleshoot, they'll listen to you and you can guide them and make it better. Make it better for everybody. People know me from my Facebook group, but I would say most people have heard of me because of my digital exhibit stamps. I call this my pandemic project. when there was talk about remote depots, I started wondering how we were going to mark exhibits. I use an iPad for my order forms with an annotation app, so I thought I would try to see if I could mark an exhibit that way. Well, I set something up, but it wasn't very efficient. So I got on the internet and I started searching and ended up on dynamic stamps. And then the rest is history. I found a free exhibit stamp that was floating around on the internet, and then I posted it in my Facebook group. And then I had a few meetings, some really large meetings, where I would describe how to install them, and then I would give a stamp to people. At some point, I figured out how to create them from scratch. And then I had put so much time into it, and demand was so high, I started selling them. One of the hardest parts in the beginning was installing the stamps. And it's still a little bit of a challenge, even though I've changed the installation process. So I'd have workshops, sometimes during the week, mostly on the weekends. Eventually had to have my friend step in and help me train people. In these trainings, it wasn't just how to install the exhibit stamps and how to use them. It ended up being giving a lot of Windows instruction, how to get an exhibit out of the chat in Zoom, how to get it back into the chat in Zoom, and so many other things, and just learning how to use Zoom. That took up quite a bit of my time. Eventually, my stamp delivery was set up to where the hard part that was initially such a pain to explain to people how to do, I eliminated that. And for the most part, it was pretty seamless. After a while, I started getting busier with work. Now I've stopped selling them because I can't put the time into it that I want to be able to help everybody. There is something exciting coming. I am a member of a PDF scripting site that I learned most of the scripting from, which is the, quote, programming in the stamps. And we have created a stamp tool that installs just like any other program. It goes into Adobe. You don't have to go outside of Adobe to customize the exhibit stamps. When you purchase, you will be able to use the tool on two different devices. And even before you purchase, you can download the stamp tool and try it out and see if you like it. Of course, it will be watermarked, but still you can see the different features and how easy it is to install and use. Here are a few features on the stamp tool. You can customize the text on the stamp, even the font and the color. You can change the color of the stamp itself, as well as change the color of the border. The stamps auto-increment, so you don't even have to enter the exhibit number. For those of you that are using my stamps right now, with this tool, you can still use the K shortcut. If you work for different reporting firms, you can create templates inside this tool. And you can do the same thing for different cases that you work on. If you're working on the same case and you have a template, it saves the last exhibit number. So when the case comes up again, you can open up a template and start stamping and pick up where you left off. You can change the size of the stamp. This tool will work in Acrobat Reader, and there will be a version for Mac. I know I've given you a lot of information today, and I hope that some of it you found really helpful. And I hope that I've inspired you to get excited about Steno, to get excited about learning new things, and to be open to learn new things. Because we are living in different times now, so we have to adapt. It's been a pleasure talking to you today. I want to thank Shawnice for asking me to co-host this episode. And I hope that you have a great 2021. Thanks for listening to Confessions of a Stenographer. Bye.